This is B.J. Edwardson. I'm speaking from the grounds of Central Lutheran in Casa Grande. And we miss everyone that isn't able to be with us. And we are going on with our services, and it's very effective. And we hope you can join us online or anytime. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to this fifth Sunday of after the Epiphany. We welcome all of you at home, and we welcome those who are worshiping with us today. First reading is from the 40th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and it is the inhabitants are like grasshoppers who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth. When he blows upon them, they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? Who brings out the host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel for this day is written in the first chapter of the Gospel according to St. Mark. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I'll bet you didn't know that Peter was married, but in this text, Peter's mother-in-law is being healed. They also brought to him many people who were sick and possessed with demons, and he cured many. Now, if you talk to people that aren't Christians, their biggest obstacle to belief is that of miracles. How can we believe that God changes the laws of nature through healings and through miracles and walking on water and changing water into wine? And I would suggest how you perceive the world affects how you respond to the text. Modern science believes in a cause and effect world. When God acts, he breaks the chain of events. He changes the rules. He interrupts the cause and effect in the world. A pastor was told, "I prayed that my father would get well, but he died." Another person said, "I prayed that my little sister wouldn't get into trouble like me." If God truly loves me, why does he let me suffer so? How can we respond? The Isaiah text, the first text for today, says, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless." When we reflect on our faith in God as the creator and provider of all, our first response should be that of gratitude. For we are not a minuscule part of a great cosmic machine grinding in an unalterable way through time. We are children of God. We are created in God's image, objects of his love and care, partners with God in the ongoing creative process we call life. But if God truly loves me, why does God let me suffer? I have a plaque that my mother gave me a long time ago that's hanging in my office at my home. It says, "Pray to God, but row toward shore." And it has a guy with a rowboat. In other words, don't expect God to care for you all the time. You got to care for yourself too. Paul speaks about the freedom of the gospel. We are free from fate, from control of destiny. God gives us the freedom of choice. Not as if it's all planned out regardless of what we choose. To say that God knows the future does not imply that God makes the future happen. Jesus is not just the supreme forerunner of modern surgeons or exorcists. Jesus is the agent of God sent to change the laws of nature when it suits his fancy. In Christ we have been freed from sin, from the powers of evil and death. Not that we are no longer in sin, not that we no longer suffer and die, but we have a destiny with God, empowered as God's partners in this creative order. Tend the garden, work in the vineyard. That's the thought, that's through the faith of our neighbor, fate of the world might be changed. We have witnessed the supreme example of our calling in our Lord Jesus Christ, who came into our world preaching the good news, teaching discipleship and healing every kind of disease. He has called on us to follow that. And so let us remember that God does not make everything happen, but we have a hand in that. We have a hand in this world. God has given us the freedom to make decisions, and God gives us the freedom to follow Him. Amen. Continue with the prayers. Comfort and support all who suffer in any way. Especially we lift up in prayer this day Sandy, Patricia, Donna, Ray, Azure, Norby, Pat and Bud, Mary and Dave, Paula, Larry, Richie, Marjorie, Henry and Sandy, Phil and Brenda, and Patty Joe, and all that we name in our voices before you. Lord, in your mercy, for these things we bring before you and for all that you see that we need, grant us, O God, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, gave it for all to drink, and saying, This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. We pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.